Adam, thanks so much for joining me.
Absolutely. Thanks, Eric.
Well, first question, I've teased this on the show a little bit. I laugh because it's kind of ludicrous to me, but perhaps you could fill us in. It seems like the storyline this week is how dare Washington even bother to show up this week and compete against the mighty Alabama Crimson Tide. I imagine Washington's probably getting a little tired of hearing that.
I think they are. They're doing a good job of handling it and handling the questions. But look, obviously we're in the South here, and Huskies have come a long way. And as I was just saying, you know, Alabama media right now is outnumbering the Seattle West Coast media probably 10-1 at this point. So I think we've got a few more reinforcements coming in before the game on Saturday. But I think it's a natural sort of storyline too for Alabama folks, Alabama media to ask. The Huskies, you know, how great is Alabama? Talk about this great Alabama defense. Is this the best defense you'll ever see? And certainly they're getting a little tired of talking about that, because particularly for Washington's defense, you know, they're by far, maybe not by far, but they're the best in the Pac-12. And you know, they've been really good for a couple of years now. Obviously doesn't compare to Alabama's dynasty and everything they've got going defensively. But, you know, the Huskies are a confident group too, coming off a blowout win in the Pac-12 championship game. They've come a long way, and they've done a lot of good things this year. So I'm sure that, you know, they're not saying it, but I'm sure inside, deep down inside, you know, the no respect factor will play at least a little bit of a role going into Saturday. Will that matter? I don't know. But they've done a good job all year of, as they say, you know, all the cliche, blocking out the media, blocking out the noise. That's really been at the forefront of everything they've done, because there's been so much hype about this team even going back to the summer. And I think they've handled it pretty well so far this week.
I don't know him well, but Chris Peterson seems like the type that would almost prefer this kind of narrative, this kind of storyline, where he can he doesn't maybe want to be the underdog per se, but he almost enjoys being able to play that card a little
bit. Oh, it's perfect. No, you're spot on there. It's absolutely perfect. It fits to his personality. I think that was a huge reason why he stayed in Boise State for as long as he did, just because, you know, he's kind of that – he's got that small-town mindset. He grew up in Northern California, kind of a small town, and I think that just fits who he is, and he doesn't mind sort of playing second fiddle. You know, obviously Alabama's defending national champion. It's Alabama. Everyone knows, even up in the Northwest, knows what Alabama's all about, and I think you're right. This fits in perfectly with what Chris Peterson's trying to preach to his team. Hey, you know, don't do any talk, and let's just let it our play show who we are on Saturday. We'll put our best foot forward. Doesn't matter what anyone's saying right now anyway. And as one of the UW offensive linemen said yesterday, pretty aptly, said, you know what, if it was up to you guys in the media, we shouldn't even show up Saturday. You know, what's the point? So I think they've handled it well. They've handled it with some humor like that. Chris Peterson has as well. But it really goes back to, like I said, everything he's done, even going back to the offseason, was approach this sort of stuff head on, because he could see it coming. He knew the attention was coming. He doesn't want to get his team all wrapped up in it. Even then, when it was all good, he doesn't want them to get it caught up in it now when it's mostly negative.
Jake Browning, I think most people agree that the key to the game for Washington, if they're going to win this, is Jake. And I've read some analysts and heard people talking that he may have suffered a little bit from arm fatigue toward the end of the year. Any truth to that? And you think this break did him pretty good?
Yeah, I asked him kind of point blank a couple weeks ago back in Seattle about that. He completely dismissed it. I didn't expect him to be right. Like, oh, yeah, my arm was dead, you know. But, you know, I floated that out there a little bit too, that, you know, he sort of looked like a young pitcher in the major leagues who had thrown 200 innings for the first time in his career, and come September, early October, you know, in this baseball hypothetical, you know, he just looked like he maybe lost a few miles per hour off his fastball a little bit. So, yeah, I don't know if that they completely shut him down in early December after the, you know, bull pairing was set up. But I know his workload was really light. They had class finals. They didn't practice for a full week. So I do think that was a priority for them, to get him specifically some rest. And, yeah, I would buy into that theory a little bit. Like I said, he just didn't, particularly in the Pac-12 championship game against Colorado, I think he was 9 of 24, career low 118 yards. It's just not what we're used to seeing out of Jake Browning this year. I think up until that game, he probably would have been a Heisman finalist. He was really close. But his calling card is his accuracy. And to see him go 9 of 24, something had to be off a little bit there. So I do think that was part of it, 13-game season. He'd been beat up a little bit. For the most part, UW's offensive line has kept him clean. But, yeah, I do think 2 or 3 weeks of light work and some rest should do him well come Saturday.
Talking to Adam Jude, the Washington beat writer for the Seattle Times, I know this is an kind of a silly question because it is what it is, but Washington is so good at taking the football away. I believe they've created 33 turnovers on the year. They're number one in turnover margin. What is it about that defense that is so ball hawking that they're, I mean, 33 takeaways is a lot, almost three a game.
Yeah, and it starts, you know, with that secondary with so much of that defense. Again, Buda Baker, he's small, but he's just all over the field. And this is a guy who's a relentless competitor. He was at a powerhouse high school in Seattle, Bellevue High School. I think he won a state championship every year, and I think they won maybe a mythical national championship one year too. That was a school that went, I think, 10 years without a loss or something. So he's accustomed to winning, and he's accustomed to he's not losing anything. You watch him in practice in the few chances we get to watch practice. But he's a guy, even just their sprints during warmups and stuff, he has to be first at everything. And so everything kind of starts with Buda Baker at safety. Sidney Jones is probably going to be a first-round pick at cornerback. Kevin King looks like Richard Sherman, just his length, 6'3", 200 pounds at cornerback, too. And so much of it is those guys back there. But UW's defensive line, it's the best defensive line in the Pac-12. Again, I think folks out here in the South are used to seeing those big, beefy guys. But, you know, they're 320, 320, and 330 up front, and I think they match up pretty well. I don't know that I would say they have an advantage over Alabama's offensive line, but I do think they match up well. And to me, getting that push and keeping Jalen Hurts in the pocket is obviously the Huskies' defensive game plan. They're going to want Jalen Hurts. They're going to try to make him beat him through the air. Again, that goes right into the Huskies' strength in their deep and versatile secondary. So, the turnover thing, again, it's, you know, every team preaches it, every team practices it. It's something we've heard out of this coaching staff since they arrived 3 years ago. And again, I think that just goes back to being a sharp veteran group where they know what they're doing. They know what's coming, and they can make the plays when the ball does come.
That's certainly been the storyline this week with Alabama's offense. Ole Miss head coach Hugh Freeze says to beat Alabama, he thinks you got to make Jalen Hurts throw the football, and you reference that in probably the Huskies' game plan. Did they face anyone similar in style this season to Jalen?
Yeah, this doesn't bode well for the Huskies, but the comparison I would make, and I've heard the Huskies make too, is Sam Darnold for USC. Alabama didn't really see him. I think he attempted a handful of passes in that season opener, but he's not a guy who – he's not as fast and he doesn't run as much as Jalen Hurts, but he's a guy who he beat the Huskies by extending plays, and they thought they could, cover those USC receivers, you know, one-on-one a lot, and they let a couple of those guys get away, and Sam Darnold made some great plays. One particular play I have in mind just found a receiver in the back of the end zone after he spread far to the field, and it's that type of play where, again, you're going to beat a lot of defenses if you have a mobile quarterback who can extend plays, because even with an elite secondary, you can only cover for so long. That's just standard football. So, I do think he compares well to Sam Darnold. And again, the Huskies didn't handle Sam Darnold very well, which I think goes back a lot to, you know, why Alabama and why Alabama fans have a lot of confidence in this matchup. The transitive property, I think we've both written about a little bit. But look, I mean, you look at what Alabama did to USC, and you look what UW did to USC. That doesn't bode well for the Huskies. That said, you know, obviously this whole month off and the time to prepare, I mean, I think it's going to be a lot closer than a lot of people think. Yeah. I'm not predicting Huskies are going to win, but I do give them a shot to shock the world, and in large part because of that defense and what they've been able to do this year.
I know Chris Peterson's not the type to make excuses, but any private concerns or any private gripes that, listen, they're from Seattle. This was 2,000 miles away. It's 3 hours away from Alabama. You mentioned the media not being outnumbered here, but I imagine the fans might be outnumbered. Was there any concern that maybe they should be playing in Glendale and Clemson or Ohio State should be playing here?
You wouldn't hear that from the Huskies. Husky fans, certainly when the playoff seedings and matchups were announced, you know, we're a little disappointed in that. I thought the Huskies had a decent chance to maybe move up to three, just because of the way they finished against Colorado. But the one thing we heard all year from the ESPN talking heads and the committee members themselves was that, obviously the Huskies' weak non-conference schedule in September, you know, was a hurdle they had to overcome, and they did to get in at number four. But, I don't think the committee wanted to reward such a bad non-conference schedule by moving them up to two or three. So, I think most Husky fans were pretty happy just to get in, and you you wouldn't hear the Huskies make that excuse or, you know, complain about that publicly. But again, to me, I thought there was a chance that they could go to Arizona. But, you know, I think when you look at the matchups and the committee certainly takes that stuff into account. They would have had a whole lot of Husky fans traveling to Arizona, much easier trip, a lot of Husky fans in California. But yeah, to me, ultimately, this is probably the most realistic scenario for them being the sort of newcomers, the new kids on the block and all that.
You mentioned the non-conference schedule, and that was a big concern, you know, during selection day. Was that done before Peterson?
That was rectified going forward. It was even a different athletic director at the time, Scott Woodward, who's now at Texas A&M. As you know, I mean, that stuff goes back sometimes 5-6 years in advance. And so Huskies have, I mean, they've traditionally scheduled very tough. I think it was 2012. They went down to LSU. They've had Notre Dame the past 10 years. They traditionally want to get, you know, one legitimate Power Five. Like most programs, you want to get one good game on your schedule. And they've got home and home with Michigan scheduled in the next few years. And I think part of it, this was Wisconsin backed out of a home and home they had scheduled. I think it was supposed to start next year, but I think Wisconsin backed out in part to play LSU early in the year like they did this year. But yeah, again, that was such a huge topic, you know, in Seattle, the non-conference schedule. Why is this so weak? Why weren't you guys scheduled tougher? Chris Peterson certainly got tired of answering that question. But that's, you know, you can go back to his days at Boise State. You know, he's never been afraid to schedule tough games, tough opponents. No one would ever travel to Boise, but he was always willing to go somewhere and play whoever, in part because Boise State had to do that to get some respect. But I don't think Chris Peterson will shy away from games like that if it's on his docket.
And he has won a game in the Georgia Dome when he was the coach at Boise, beat Georgia. Wrapping up here with Adam Jude, the Washington Huskies football beat writer for the Seattle Times. I don't know if there's any way to quantify this, and not that Washington needs to raise its profile. I mean, crying out loud, they won the Pac-12, but what would a victory over Alabama on national television, the college football playoff, could it even raise the program to a different level?
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, look, they up until this year, I made a big deal about this early in the year, but they opened up, you know, a complete remodeled Husky Stadium, $280 million complete renovation that opened 3 years ago in 2013, and they went 2.5 years without a sellout there. You know, seats about 70,000 people. And so they finally got a sellout in September, Friday night game versus Stanford, first top 10 matchup in Husky Stadium since 1997. And, you know, UW's athletic department was at a, you know, $7-8 million deficit this year, too. So much was riding on this football team kind of getting back to this stage or getting back to winning ways and selling tickets. So, obviously, if anybody beats Alabama, you're going to elevate yourself to another level. I think they've gotten so far this year anyway. You go 12-1, they were dormant for so long. They got to the Rose Bowl in 2000 with Rick Neuheisel, and then, you know, the program just completely collapsed after that. They were 0-12 in 2008 with Tyrone Willingham, and it's hard to go 0-12 as a major college program with the resources they have, with the city of Seattle. It's hard to do that, and so it was obviously really difficult to pull themselves out of that, and here they are, you know, 8 years later, finally back on the national stage. But it's interesting timing this year, too, for the program, because it's the 25-year anniversary of their shared national championship in 1991, and I think for a long time, Husky fans, this feels right. This feels like where they want to be, obviously where they want to be, but where they should be and where they were for a long time under Don James. And they think, you know, Chris Peterson is Don James reincarnated. Can they keep it going? You know, I think for me, 2017 was supposed to be the breakout year for this program. Jake Browning's going to be a junior next year. So I really don't think they're going away anytime soon either. I think Chris Peterson, he's in it for the long haul at Seattle. It's not a stepping stone for him. He wants the big time to be there at UW.